Another episode of Mind Your Business, the podcast where I chat to a different business owner each week to get the story behind their business journey and how they built their brand. So today I'm joined by Laura, who is a founder of the Glasglow Girls Club.
Hello.
Welcome, Laura. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you for having me.
So why don't you tell us a wee bit more about the Glasglow Girls Club?
So the Glasglow Girls Club started life as a forum for women from Glasgow and the surrounding areas just to promote their own businesses, ask for recommendations and advice, promote events, basically so that everybody got the most out of life in the city. So it basically was an idea that I had in my front room one Sunday, I think, that I thought I wanted to start a forum. And actually, I lie, because I'd had like a vision or an epiphany, I guess, when I was in my early 20s to have a forum for women.
Right.
Because when the internet first came out, showing my age now, it was all chat rooms, and that was really like a big thing, and I loved a chat room. So I kind of thought to myself, I'd love to create one that's purely for women, because obviously as a woman you would always get creeped on in these chat rooms, and that wasn't really what
proper,
you were
weirdos on those.
You weren't looking for that. You were looking for like community. You were looking for people to share like hobbies and passions with. So I'd spoke to my cousin who is in publishing, and he had more knowledge at that time of the internet and different things. And he'd said to me, you're going to need a, like, that's going to be big website, big budget, lot of money. And at that time I'd kind of just started working at Fake Bake. I was the marketing manager at Fake Bake. So and when I was in my early 20s, I was like out every weekend, living life, partying. So it probably wouldn't have been the right time for me to have thought about it anyway. So when you fast forward, maybe about 9 years, I had thought to myself, maybe not as long as that, maybe seven, Facebook groups had come out. Mark Zuckerberg was really pushing them, because he was trying to promote the fact that Facebook doesn't take people away from real life, it actually creates communities. So I thought, well, there's a free way of starting a forum for women in Glasgow, and it's free for them to join, free for me to make, and I would just see how it went. I had no expectations of how big it was going to get. I had no plans of creating a business from it. I just wanted it to be something that was useful for women, and useful for friends as well, because I had a lot of friends at the time that had their own businesses. Because I was always the marketing person, they would say, like, how do we reach new audiences? How do we? So I thought, well, this is going to be good for them, because it's effectively creating a database for business owners to promote their own business to. So that's what happened at launch. I think within 3 days it had about 800 members.
Wow.
Which was brilliant. People were just adding their friends, their family members, and then from there it was just a kind of steady growth until now. So it's actually been, it was July, so this is like the 3 year really anniversary of the Facebook group, and now I think it's sitting at about 15.3.
that's so good. Thousands. 3 years, that's
so, it's great.
Yeah,
I mean, don't get me wrong, there's other Facebook groups that have skyrocketed as well. Like, it seems to be a real platform for people these days, but it's been, it's a real project of passion for me, because it's just something that I get lots of great feedback on. People take away from it. People are making new connections from it. And that's kind of the reason it all started.
Yeah, because all day, every day, you see people kind of posting, looking for recommendations, helping each other out. So that must be crazy for you to kind of see that community.
It's really, really great. There's and you see so much, like, support and camaraderie and I've got guidelines, obviously, so that was a lesson for me, kind of, in creating a group, because I'd never done anything like that before. So I've got guidelines to follow, which kind of keeps everything on a positive space. I don't allow any confrontation or any bitchiness or anything like that. So any things like that get reported to me, and they're just removed, and potentially the members removed as well, because I just don't have any time for that.
No, I think it is quite a positive community, though, because there is a lot on Facebook that are quite bitchy and negative and cliquey, kind of, but I've never really seen that on
good.
I think it's that's a good positive space.
I don't like that type of behaviour. I actually have always been a person that's hated confrontation.
I'm the same. So I'm horrible at it.
Anything like that between people, I'm just, like, not allowed.
No.
Like,
we didn't need that. You've got that enough in your real life, that you see the kind of place that you can,
and I think the internet as well, it's, people do need to be, especially people that are more sensitive, need to be sort of cautious, because obviously everybody knows, unfortunately, that bullying goes on in real life, but it's people that hide behind computers, like the trolls, mm-hmm. that could be even worse, I think.
Yeah.
So that's why I think it's just keeping a close eye on everything and just making sure that that doesn't happen.
Mm-hmm. So is that quite a lot of work for you then?
It's a lot of work. Yeah, it is actually a lot of work that goes on behind the scenes. I get so many messages from people as well.
Yeah.
So it is a sort of constant thing. At the moment, it's just me that manages the GGC in terms of I then took it to the next stage and created the private members website.
Yeah.
But I have added my cousin as an admin, so that she's also got the power to remove and delete, because yeah. she would be sending me things that I was missing. I was out of meetings all day.
That's only natural, though. You're busy to keep an eye on that. It must be
exactly
a full-time job.
It is. It's a total yeah. full-time job, and it's worth it because it's helping people.
Yeah.
But that side of the GGC for me obviously isn't monetized. That's just yeah. something that I do to make sure that everyone gets a lot from it.
Mm-hmm.
And then at the end of last year, December the 10th, I launched the private members website.
Yeah.
So I kind of took the decision at the end of, well, I think maybe the year before, the year prior to that, as I said, mm-hmm. I was working as a marketing manager at Fake Bake. The group at that point, I think, was maybe about 6,000 or 7,000.
Right.
And I was turning 30, or I'd just turned 30. And I thought to myself, what are you doing? It was like one of those moments where you're mm-hmm. like, what are you doing with your life?
Yeah.
Are you always going to work for someone, mm-hmm. which is amazing, and there's so many perks for working with someone, and you yeah. really quickly learn that when you go self-employed.
Yeah.
Or do you want to try and be your own boss, basically? Mm-hmm. And because I don't have a family, yeah. I was like, well, this is the right time.
Mm-hmm.
And if it doesn't work, I would go back to employment, and, you know, yeah. that wouldn't be an issue. But I thought, you know, just take the chance, because mm-hmm. I'd always kind of had it in me ever since I was younger. I'd love to have my own business.
Yeah.
And I guess that's like one of those itches that need scratched, like it never yeah. really goes away.
I think it's definitely in you, and I think if you kind of yeah. try and ignore it, you can only do it for so long.
You can only do it for so long, and then you start to be unhappy with what yeah. you're doing,
resentful in your
exactly
your day job kind of thing.
And my yeah. day job was brilliant, so mm-hmm. I was like, right, you just need to take the call. And I thought I could have done something else, or I thought, I think this GGC is really taking off. People like the community, like the whole members club idea has obviously been around for centuries in terms of actual, like, real buildings where
yeah.
people would go and have clubs and stuff like that. Mm. But this idea of a digital membership was only really just coming over from America.
Yeah, it's quite a new concept.
Yeah.
yeah.
So I just took the risk, did the sort of invested in the website, which is mm-hmm. Something which was a real labour of love.
Yeah.
But I'm so happy with it. And yeah, just took the risk and launched it as a private members club, and yeah, it's going well.
Yeah, so that was the end of last year that launched.
So that's been launched now for about 6 months.
Yeah.
So it's I think in business you learn stuff every day.
Mm-hmm.
Like, especially when you're doing everything on your own at the yeah. beginning, because you need to be every type of person.
Yeah, about 10 jobs.
About 10 jobs, exactly. So you learn really fast, and you learn on your feet, and you make a lot of mistakes.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that when you feel like you've failed at something, mm-hmm. it's what you take away from that.
Yeah,
so it's
totally.
You can make success out of failure, and it's just kind of trying to learn from every time that you feel like you've been knocked down.
Yeah.
Right, what have I learned from that? Right, and how can I do it differently?
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of, it's just constant.
Yeah, I think there is a lesson in everything that you kind of fail at. I think you sort of need to go through those.
Oh, you do.
Kind of,
you absolutely
gain
do.
Gain confidence,
like,
and
yeah.
know actually what you want to
that's
be
how
doing.
You learn as well. It's mm-hmm. how you learn in life. Like, if you make a mistake in life, that's how you learn for the next time. Like, when you're a wee kid and you burn your hand yeah. or something, you then know you're not going to put your
yeah.
hand on the stove or
no
do whatever
again.
Uh-huh.
So is there any those mistakes that you kind of feel have ended up helping you in the long run, maybe any that you're making at the very start?
I feel as though probably every mistake I've made helps me in the long run, because I always look for the lessons
mm-hmm.
in the mistakes. I can't think of like one like massive mistake. I would say it's just a succession of
mm-hmm.
sort of many mistakes and failures that I've just learned from.
Yeah.
I think it's really easy when you first go into business to think, right, this is going to just, like, the minute I press like live, it's just going to sell.
Yeah.
And I think most business owners that I've spoke to that have launched something have kind of thought that that would happen. But it's just kind of learning, no, you still need to, like, you can't just put something live and then sit back. You need to put something, you need to plan a campaign before it goes live, and then you need to continuously put yourself out there.
Yeah, I suppose it can be quite deflating if you've worked on this for so long, it's like your baby, and you put it out and you're not getting hundreds, thousands of people instantly.
Oh, I know.
It's quite a tough thing to deal with.
But that is a tough thing to deal with. And for me, when I first put it live, it did so well, and it was trying to keep that momentum and learn different strategies to get it out there and try and get the word of mouth and all that. So it has all been a learning, and I think I would never say that I'm an expert in like members clubs, because I'm still learning so much every day. Maybe if I was to chat to you in like 5 years, I would maybe be like, right, okay, I've got a good formula for it now. But I think every day's a learning. I think you need to be open to that learning as a business person, to progress, really. I think upskilling and widening your network are all so important.
So do you do a lot of networking then, kind of businesses?
I do a lot of networking. I do, actually. The GGC has got its own monthly networking event. So that's really good for me, because it actually enables me to network with all the girls that come, without having to look too much into other networking that's available.
Yeah.
I do go to a couple of things, but I always think as well, it's managing your diary. That's probably the biggest lesson that I've learned. It's managing your diary. And if you're going to networking, and I think having a wide network is so important. So see, even if you're going to a networking event and you don't get business from it, you've maybe met like 30 people who are part of your network, so you know what they do. So something will come up down the line where they need to use you or you need to use them. So sometimes it's not getting that immediate return from networking, but it's just being safe in the knowledge. But by you putting yourself out there, you're going to be remembered. And I think it's so important for business owners.
I think it's a scary thing to do, I think, to kind of put yourself out there. And especially when, I like your idea, it's kind of like a speed networking. I love that idea.
I'd been to a few networkings and just felt so awkward. Like, and I think as well with networkings, it's always quite good to go on your own, because I think if you go with someone, you're naturally going to stay in that safety of that person. But whereas when you go on your own, it's like, right, no, you need to make yourself known to people. And I think if it's not a speed networking situation where you're physically actually forced to have 5 minutes or 2 minutes or however long with each person, then you're having to go up to a group of people who are in the midst of a conversation. And it was always something that I felt a bit nervous about.
That kind of approaching someone is. So I've been to a few kind of the big ones where you go in and it's like a breakfast meeting. They're on the big table and it's really like quite formal, and it's not for me.
That's the thing, like, because there's different styles of networking that are for different styles of businesses, like you say, like the corporate ones are very much so geared towards corporate, whereas the GGC networking events are more about inspiring and having a laugh and engaging with people. So there's always an inspirational speaker at the beginning to get ladies like buzzed up and feel like, oh well, do you know, I always think when you hear an inspirational story from another businesswoman or man, you think, okay, like, I'm ready to tell my story. So it starts with that, and then there's normally, in the evenings, there is normally fizz, which obviously helps. Fizz and cake. And then, you get 5 minutes with each person, and they're just always a pure laugh. So that's kind of what I aim for, more than people feeling nervous and the kind of opposite. The more corporate. GGC isn't corporate.
No. I think that's better. Like, I can't go into those situations and be comfortable, but going into a group of kind of women all owning their own business, that's a lot.
It's a lot easier. Absolutely.
A lot easier to kind of talk about yourself, as you say, tell your story.
Comfortable. I have women that message me, like, they book a ticket and then they message me and they say, like, I'm really, really nervous. And I'm like, honestly, like, I promise you, I'm not just saying this. You'll be nervous walking in.
It's just going in the door. It's always horrible.
And then, you know, you'll be handed a glass of fizz and you'll be introduced to people, and then the speaking starts and you'll feel great. So that's, I do hope, and the feedback is lovely. So if that helps, yeah, then that's good.
They always seem really busy, those events, so it's obviously...
I only ever allow like maximum 30 people because I think any more than that it gets too busy and then it can be overwhelming for people and you can't ever really get round everyone, so there needs to be time at the end to chat. Actually, my issue is getting the women to move on.
Yeah, once it starts.
So it's 5 minutes that you get, and then I'll make some kind of stupid noise, whether it's a glass and a cup, or I've actually started taking a megaphone because it makes a really annoying noise, and it's like a kind of siren.
Yeah.
And like it gets to maybe like 6 or 7 minutes, and I'm like, come on, girls, you need to move on because it only benefits you.
You're like the teacher.
I know, and then I'm like, Jock, do you know what, if they're wanting to chat, it's fine. It's their event as well, so.
I suppose that's a good problem to have, that people are having...
Too much. I know, it's brilliant, I know. So they go well together, but yeah, no, I'm enjoying. Do you enjoy your own business?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely.
You could never go back?
I don't think so, no. I think, like you said, I think it was always kind of in me as well.
Yeah.
Like, I've always kind of wanted to own a shop or, like, stupid things, like, as I was when I was really small, but
okay.
I think I lasted maybe about a year in, like, my after uni job, and I couldn't do it.
That was it.
It was maybe a bad, it was a bad boss, but maybe that kind of put me off.
Yeah.
But I just thought, you know what, probably I should have worked for experience for maybe 10, 15 years and then went for it, but
no.
I like to just do things on a whim.
Yeah, I think sometimes the greatest things can come out of whims as well. And I don't think, like, I did work for 10 years, but don't get me wrong, you do learn lessons. You learn lessons when you're working full-time as well. But I think if you're ready, you're ready. And you're going to be learning those same lessons on your own as well.
So did you kind of find it harder because obviously you liked your job? You said it was a great job. So was that kind of a harder jump to leave?
Yeah, I did. Like, it was really like, right, you need to really want to do this.
Yeah.
I'm still so close with Fake Bake, so they're a partner of the GGC.
Yeah, yeah.
Sandra, who runs it, is a wow woman. Mm-hmm. So I was actually in seeing her last Tuesday, and she's always got words of wisdom for me because obviously she's created an empire.
Mm-hmm.
So she's got words of wisdom for me, and I still do stuff with Fake Bake, so that's allowed me to kind of keep my kind of relationship with them.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it is. It's really hard, but I think when you've got your own business, you're so passionate about it.
Yeah.
So a lot of the time it doesn't feel like work.
No.
Because you're loving what you're doing, and because it's for yourself, you know that anything extra you do, it pays off directly to you.
Mm-hmm.
So there's that element of, like, control over your own destiny as well, which I think is quite nice.
Yeah, I think that's what would kind of be hard if you were to go back, kind of relinquishing that control. And I think once you get used to it,
I know,
it's great.
Well, that's it. Like, I couldn't go back because if I went back into full-time employment, I would want to be like, right, I'm going for meetings now, or I'm going to finish up today because I'm working tonight, or just things that wouldn't probably work for most bosses. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, they've got their own way of working. So I need the freedom now.
That's great. If something ever pops up or someone asks you to do something, you can be like, all right, okay, I'll pick up a couple hours later, or I'll start earlier. Or...
I know, I'm trying to tag on to my mum and dad's holiday in a couple of weeks. And because I do my own thing, I don't need to ask anyone's permission. I just need to make sure that my diary's okay for it. So, and that again, that's something, if you were working full time, you would maybe get a no if other people were on holiday. So it kind of... There's so many pluses and minuses of self-employment and employment. There really is. I think it would be hard for a lot of people to go back after going out self-employed.
Yeah, I think so. But I also think maybe a lot of people wouldn't be able to cope with the self-employed.
Oh, absolutely.
I think it's harder than people think.
It really is harder. And I think it's quite lonely.
Yeah.
As well, because at the moment, as I mentioned earlier, on the business side of things, it's just me.
Mm-hmm.
But my dream is to have a team, because I'd love to give people the opportunity. And also, that's the surefire way of scaling up any business.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, when you're on your own, you're just like, I've got the best wee relationship with my wee dog.
Mm-hmm.
So I ask her questions, but the answers never come back. So I'm always like, right. So I actually started doing things as part of the business membership called Glow Groups.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just like business members of the website get together every month, sometimes like twice a month if they want. There is two sessions that are put on, and it's just come along, just a chat, brainstorm, like everybody bring problems that they're having with their business, who can help, who can you refer people to, like share contacts. So that for me is really good because it gets me chatting to people, finding out their ideas, bouncing ideas. Sometimes you might have the best idea but you might not have the confidence to put it forward because nobody's giving you any feedback on it.
Yeah, I think that is quite hard. Really, I had to kind of, I gave up was about a month ago and I got a wee office.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, because I was being at home. It does get, it gets so lonely, and I was kind of finding that I wasn't doing as much as I wanted to because I was lounging about, like finding other things
hard
to do.
Hard to get the line between work and...
Yeah, so I feel like that's kind of made a difference, and it's also like there's other people in, it's a kind of an enterprise hub.
Okay.
So there's other people there in their own wee offices, so there's kind of people in the kitchen to have a wee chat to, so I'm not chatting to my dog.
Oh, I know.
But
like
she's raging at me.
Oh, did she go into the office with you?
No.
No, not allowed.
So she's left at home, so I feel terrible every morning.
Oh, you can't know.
Their wee face.
You need to do what's right for you, though.
I know.
Don't you? I did have that issue because I literally last year was just sitting on the spare room bed, like working.
Yeah.
My wee dog was just lying beside me snoring, and my husband was like, when are you going to make that room an office? And actually, so I had to do that at the start of the year, and it's made such a world of difference because that's my kind of differentiation. Mm-hmm. I'm actually quite good when I'm in the house. Like, I don't watch TV or anything like that. Like, I do have it, but it's more my wee dog. She couldn't be left in, so I'm just like, oh, well, I'm in the house for you.
Yeah. Oh.
But it's good. It's good.
Just find out what works for you, I think. Yeah, I think you need to kind of try it and see.
Yeah, you do.
See what works.
You do. And ultimately, you do need to be productive. So if you're not being productive in the house, it's not the right environment for you to work.
Yeah, because I was kind of, every week I was like, oh, waiting for something magically to change sort of thing.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, this week will be better. This week I'll get loads done.
Yeah.
And I was in that kind of headspace where I wasn't going to.
Yeah.
And even yesterday, I took the day off and I was working from home and I slipped straight back into that.
Oh, I did.
Sitting
so
on the couch. Like,
oh, so you know.
Yeah.
So you're like, it's definitely for you.
Yeah, when a day.
Yeah.
I was back.
Yep.
In my jammies on the couch, kind of not doing as much as I...
So then there you go.
Yeah.
I also sometimes think mixing up your environments is good. So very often, if I'm in between meetings or if I'm just out one day, I'll sit in a coffee shop.
Yeah.
And I find that I surprise myself with the productivity. So I think sometimes not getting used to one environment can help as well.
Yeah.
Because it is really easy to procrastinate.
Mm.
Especially if you are the boss.
Yeah.
Because you...
There's no one there to
There's no
to
one
tell
there to be
to
like,
do.
Have you done that yet?
Yeah.
It's just your
it's
own personal self.
It is hard. But yeah, obviously, it's called Glasgow Girls Club. That's maybe quite an self-explanatory name.
Yes.
But was there ever any other names, in the running when you were thinking up?
Well,
when you were starting?
A lot of people still don't know that it's Glasglow. A lot.
It took me months.
I know, honestly. And I think it's hilarious. Like, I get messages from girls like, oh, do you know that there's a typo?
Oh,
and I'm like, oh, no, it's not. It's actually just from, like, because from a marketing perspective, having glow helps me because I've then got the glow getters, I've got the glow groups,
yeah.
It's good pillars for me to use. So Glasglow, I was just kind of in that front room again, just thinking, right, what could I call it? And I did think Glasglow Women's Club, Glasglow Ladies Club. It was always a club and it was always going to be Glasglow.
Right.
So I just had to think of the middle word. And I have spoke to some ladies that have said, oh, because it's girls, it would put me off.
Yeah.
And I'm like, well, I get that for some people, but I always think that everyone's got an inner child.
Yeah.
So, and I refer to women as women, girls, ladies.
Mm-hmm.
It's all, for me personally, I'm just like, well, it doesn't make a difference. So obviously it is a shame if it puts some people off, but the branding's really unapologetic. It's bright pink.
Yeah.
It's not going to be everyone's cup of tea. The palette's like a rainbow. So it's, you know, it isn't the corporate black, grey that maybe some people prefer, and that's totally fine. But for me, from a marketing perspective as well, I didn't think Glasgow Women's Club or Glasgow Ladies Club really had the same ring to it.
No, I think the Girls Club.
The Girls Club.
Yeah.
And also, I think with my plans that I've got down the line as well, like to do merch and stuff like that, those types of names just didn't work for me.
Something.
So, and also it does get shortened to GGC.
Yeah.
GGC is dead easy.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas GLC or GWC, it just doesn't have the same.
Yeah.
So I had all those things going through my head, and I thought, oh, do you know what? Everyone was a girl. Everyone's got an inner child.
Yeah.
And actually, the core audience of the group from my analytics is like 25 to 45. That's like the biggest core. There is a lot from 16 to 18, and there's actually a surprising a lot, like even 70, but like there's every age in that group. But like the biggest graphs are the 25 to 35 and the 35 to 45.
Right.
So that kind of shows me that it's not putting a lot of people off, like the fact that it's girls.
Yeah. So obviously you mentioned your brand in really pink, really vivid.
Yes.
So was that always, again, the kind of vision that you had?
It's when I first started the group, I just went on, I think it was Font Candy or In Light or something like that. And I knew for myself, like obviously I didn't have any money. It's like I wasn't seeing it as a business, so I wasn't like investing in it.
Yeah.
So I just thought, obviously I knew that I needed to give it an identity though. Mm-hmm. So I basically just created it, and it was at the beginning, it was a grey wall background, like with grey bricks, and it was Glasglow Girls Club, in a very similar to font to kind of what it is now.
Yeah.
And it had like big lips, like a big kind of kiss mark.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the initial identity. And then I did a pop-up shop to kind of bring it into the real life, because I'm always really conscious that events are the way of bringing it into the real life.
Yeah.
Because I love the digital life, but the real life is so important. Mm-hmm. It's so important to have a presence there. And I was just really lucky. One of my friends was a designer, and she was helping me with the kind of identity for the pop-up shop and creating marketing graphics and stuff for it. So she was like, let me look at the font that you've used, because I was like, yeah, I really kind of like that, kind of, it's like almost like a typewriter font or whatever. So she picked out a free font from online, which kind of was really close to it.
Yeah.
And just the way that she created the wee shopping graphic for me, she put the logo a certain way so that it would stand out.
Yeah.
And then I was looking at it and I was like, well, that's the logo.
Mm-hmm.
Like, so she hadn't even meant to create the logo.
Yeah, just kind of.
She just wanted to recreate happened. It on the shopping graphic, and I just looked at it and I was like, that's it.
Mm-hmm.
Like 100%, and I love it. It's so. I mean, pink for me is like, I'm weirdly obsessed with colour pink.
That's like me, all my stuff.
And people, yeah, I know, I love your branding.
People do say that to me as well, like, you know, putting people off with this like bright and your face pink, but I've never noticed. And
no.
I think if people really want to work with you, it's not going to put them off.
Like, no, definitely not.
Like, I have had guys come and they've made it through all the pink and they've managed to get me. Like, it's not about that. It's about the work you're doing.
Yeah.
So I think it needs to be something that you love.
Yeah,
I think
absolutely.
That's the most important.
And I do think, like you say, it does need to showcase like your own personality, because if you don't love your branding, you need to love your branding 100%.
Totally.
And it does need to showcase your personality. So, like, if you're bubbly, you're fun, you're willing to try different things. Like, it's not just all the one style. I think it's really good to do that and not be afraid to do that.
Yeah, because I think if I was to go maybe down the more muted, sort of professional route, it's not me.
It's not
and
you.
And I think people would tell that pretty much instantly.
Well, that's the
after,
thing.
Like, speaking to me that
that's the thing. And we know it's so important that everything's cohesive in your brand. So from your personality, because you are your brand, to how you speak, to your colour palette, to the partners you work with, it all needs to be completely cohesive so that it makes sense to the consumer. Because if there's anything that's out of whack, like, say, for example, you did go through, or we both did, and we went, a chic look rather than maybe a vibrant look. But yet we were these kind of, like, colourful characters.
Yeah.
And that doesn't then match the brand.
No.
So right away, people might not trust.
Yeah, there's that weird kind of disconnect.
So I do think that is super important for business owners when they're first starting out. To really look at your brand and look at your colour palette. Does it match you? Because you are your brand.
Yeah.
And if it's going against, if someone's saying to you, no, you should do a grey palette and you're not grey, then why would you do it?
Yeah.
So, yeah, I think that's important.
Yeah, to be kind of true to yourself.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So, what does the future hold for the GGC? Do you have any master plans? You don't have to share anything if it's top secret.
Well, what does the future hold? So, I've got so many plans. Like yourself, like if you've got a creative brain, you've always got plans. Mm-hmm. It's just picking the right ones that are going to drive the business forward. Because I want to do it all.
Mm-hmm.
But what I have learned is you need to pick the ones that drive it forward. So I guess one thing that I have really done is reinvest all the money back into the brand,
mm-hmm.
everything. And I think that's a really key thing that I've learned is, as a business owner, you have to pay yourself.
Yeah.
Because there was, literally, I've only really just started doing that.
Yeah.
And I spoke to an amazing woman called Kat Patterson, who told me about a book which I've not read yet called Profit First.
Oh yeah, I need to read that. That's on my list as well.
So many people talk about it and say good things about it.
Yeah.
And Kat fundamentally was saying to me, if you're not paying yourself,
mm-hmm.
you're not seeing a return for all your hard work.
Yeah.
You're ultimately going to end up resenting what you're doing.
Yeah, totally.
So that was a real lesson for me, because I was just putting everything back in, like, I want to do this to the website, I want to do this, I want this. And then at the end of the day, and I was only able to do that because I've got such a good support system in my husband, who's also got his own business. If Liam didn't have such a successful building company,
mm-hmm.
I wouldn't have been able to do that.
Yeah.
So, and I would have had to have taken whatever I could
mm-hmm.
to survive, or maybe have a part-time job as well.
Yeah.
So I think that's such a key thing for all business owners. Yes, reinvest your money, especially in the first year,
mm-hmm.
but reinvest it to a point and then pay yourself.
Yeah.
So this Profit First apparently is you take your pay first.
Right, okay.
And then you reinvest. So that's something that I'm starting to do, and it really does change your mindset of your business when you're earning money from it, because ultimately we all need to.
Yeah.
So that is something that I've definitely learned, but reinvesting is something that I'll always do because I'm mm-hmm. just an absolute spender.
Yeah.
For me, the dream is to have a team. Mm-hmm. If I could start off with one lady who is just ready to kind of hit the ground running, I'm probably not there yet, but hopefully soon.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm so such a big believer in no one's an expert in everything.
Yeah,
so
totally.
To have someone to bounce ideas off of and just them learn from me learn from them mm-hmm. is the dream. And then from there on in, I'd love to grow a team. I've got plans to release merchandise.
Yeah.
So that's another kind of different touch point for the group.
Mm-hmm.
And I've got some kind of other ideas in the pipeline. I want to start doing a chat show, a YouTube chat show. So again, that's another thing that is in the pipeline. I've got some plans in place, but I need to get other things all nailed and smashed. And obviously to attract as many members as I can to the membership and just have people benefiting from it.
Yeah. That side going to kind of keep growing? Do you think you're going
to
keep?
I really get what I want to. Yeah. So it's closed at the moment, but when it reopens, it'll hopefully be another good influx, because that is kind of the backbone to the business, if you like. And for me, it is really. I feel like it's affordable.
Mm-hmm.
So it's £35 a year for a personal membership. Or as a business owner, it's £70 a year, and the business owners get everything the personal members get,
mm-hmm.
plus £4.50 in the first year for your wee key ring.
Yeah, I love the wee rose gold key ring.
So many people are like, oh, I've just joined for the key ring. I'm like, please log on to the website and see all the different things that you can get from it. The key ring's great. In year two, I'm going to have an app,
right?
So I'm going to have to start working on that soon as well. So I want to kind of reduce the carbon footprint
mm-hmm.
of the business, so the app obviously being digital, and that'll allow me to do some more things as well. So have an app, and I also want to do a pay monthly option for people. So I hope to have that in line with the app coming out. So lots of plans.
How do you juggle? honestly
it's a total balance, but you know yourself, it's a total balancing act and trying to work on what is priority, which is really hard, because actually most things I do, everything's priority.
I think when you're excited about everything, it's just so hard to kind of see what you want to do first. It's just,
I know,
you want to do it all at the one time.
You want to do everything. So there's lots. And obviously for me, I've said that I do everything on my own. I don't like build the website.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not a programmer. the app will get made by the programmer.
Yeah.
Like, so there are elements in my business that I could not do. Like, I couldn't see when I did computing at school, ones and zeros. Oh, my God. No
I'm
way.
I'm the same.
Couldn't do it.
Yeah, I'm totally the same.
So I think that's another lesson as well. Like, don't sit and struggle. Like, if you're capable of doing it, then brilliant.
Yeah.
But there comes a point where you need to say, right, my time is not best spent here.
No.
So for me, I've got an accountant.
Yeah.
Because, see, numbers and maths were never my forte.
That's like me. So I really need to kind of look into that.
Oh, it's so good just to be able to keep your receipts and keep them organised. That's the main thing, I think. Keep your receipts organised.
Yeah.
And be able to just give them to your accountant with your statements, and then be able to sort out all the different things, because I just don't have that mind.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I think that's a key lesson as well. If you're really struggling or you're detesting something that you're doing,
yeah,
seriously consider outsourcing it, because, again, it's anything just to keep that passion for your business alive.
Yeah, and it'll probably end up actually costing you less in the long run if you can factor in how many hours
that you would spend
struggling.
And with accountancy as well, and when it comes to, like, HMRC, you don't want to be making any mistakes.
Yeah.
So it's like, right, give it to someone who you know is going to get it right. Because if you make mistakes with HMRC, you'd probably end up paying for it.
Yeah, I know, it's terrifying. I remember sending my first one and I was like, oh my God.
Yeah, I know.
I had to get someone in my family's actually an accountant, so I got them to kind of check it.
Brilliant.
Because it's just that fear of, like, oh my God, what if I've done this wrong?
Of course it is. They're
going to come after me.
Well, that's it. Because when you're in employment or when you've been at uni, like, you've never had to keep your own books or anything like that. So it is. It's a scary process, so that's why for me, I'm just like, not for me.
Mm-hmm.
I give it to John, bless his soul. I try to keep things organised for John. I think he's like, right, so when are you going to stop spending money? I'm like, John, come on, you know me well enough by now.
Have a heart attack every time your receipts come in.
I know, but then it's quite good to have someone that holds you accountable.
Yeah.
So it's good for him to be like, right, okay, let's look at your forecast and let's look at... And give you the kind of truth rather than you just thinking, oh, it'll be all right.
You're just sort of hiding your receipts in your drawer until...
I know.
Until tax return time.
Oh, God, I know. And that's another thing as well. I did get a lawyer.
Right.
Because I felt like the membership really needed, like, T's and C's that had been signed off by a lawyer.
Yeah.
So, again, with that, I was just like, I'm not even going to try. Because a few people had said, well, you probably could look at other people's T's and C's. And
yeah.
I was just like, do you know what? I just don't think it's worth it for me because I'm a worrier.
Yeah.
And, yeah, getting the, like, the lawyer's fees are not cheap.
No.
But having the peace of mind that should anything occur,
yeah,
I've got my lawyer to, A, give me advice, or B.
Mm-hmm.
So that's been another lesson learned. But for that, I actually went through Business Gateway.
Right.
And Business Gateway paid £900 worth of the fees.
Wow.
So I would always say, look at your options.
Yeah.
Go to places like Scottish Enterprise, Business Gateway, see what's available to you, because it is, like, when you're starting off, you do need that finance.
Yeah.
And another big lesson that I've learned is trademarking as well.
Right. So is all your stuff sort of
trademarked, because something cropped up which really made me able to use it.
Mm-hmm.
And I just think, don't go through the heartbreak of having your name, your brand, and it is, you do need to invest in it. So you could, and trademarking is one of those things when you're doing it, you wish you'd never started, because there's so many different classes, there's so many different elements to each of the classes.
Mm-hmm.
You need to select everything, and it's a real pain.
Yeah.
But for me, it's paid off.
Yeah, it's one of those things that you don't never think you'll need it until you do.
And imagine you've seen someone else with the exact same brand name doing the exact same thing. Even if it wasn't the exact same thing, it's to avoid consumer confusion.
Yeah.
And I think it's really important. So for me, that's just been another thing for people to be conscious of.
That does seem to be happening more and more. You see it a lot. On social media,
people's
products and that, like, you say their whole brands are being just stolen.
I know, it's so bad. I mean, people, like, I mean, it's unbelievable what humans could do to each other, but that is something that is just absolutely heartbreaking for a business owner, because you've worked so hard.
Yeah, it's your baby, really. So, and someone just totally taking that from you, sort of thing.
Absolutely. And I'm not well versed on the idea of patenting products or anything like that, but I know if I did have a product
that
was in that bracket, I'd be wanting to do that as well, to protect it. I always just think protect your assets.
Yeah.
Because you just never know.
Mm-hmm.
It's one of those things, you say, oh, it'll never be me.
Yeah.
And then, and Instagram is so, people are so easy to access.
Mm.
People's branding, and there's taking inspiration from someone, which is totally fine, and then there's just totally ripping it off.
Yeah, completely taking the idea.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think, as you say, you can sort of be inspired, and I think just taking, like, how could you just take someone's thing? Like,
I know.
And you're never going to have that passion that they do. I think that's the important thing. Like, if someone does that to you,
I know.
They're never going to totally recreate it, because.
Well, that's it. And the thing is, as well, it inadvertently affects people's perception of you, because if you had someone who uses your trademark who is amazing, then obviously you, there's a wee bit of a safety there, because you, obviously you'd be chatting to them about your trademark, but you would know that their reputation is that good that they're not ever going to probably do anything that would inflict on yours. But whereas if someone comes along who's a scammer, who uses your trademark, and then people would be automatically, if they have a really bad experience, and that experience reflects onto you.
Yeah.
So it's really, yeah.
Protect yourself.
Protect yourself, yeah.
No, I think that's definitely good advice. So I think I've covered everything I want to chat about.
Brilliant.
I do a little segment here called Check Them Out.
Okay.
So are there any businesses that you want to give a shout out that people need to be checking out?
God, there's...
I bet you've got loads.
Oh, there's so many businesses like that I just think are absolutely smashing it on social media. So I use... I've obviously got partners, so like they're all brilliant.
Yeah.
But there's like a few key partners that just nail it, especially like obviously thinking more specifically about Insta. So you've got like Naff, Blow, Mud. You've got like even Good Times Roll around the corner. Like they like people just some people just have the natural flair and they just nail it, and they've grown massive brands from it. But even, like, to see other brands kind of rise in the ranks as well, I use a girl called Claire Grieve who does my illustration work for the GGC. So she does all the columnists and my wee kind of icons and stuff like that. So she's at Topical Paradise underscore. She's actually so busy that she's always constantly like, oh, I need to put more on my Instagram, because she's so busy actually doing work, which I think sometimes finding the balance as well. But her stuff is wow.
Yeah.
There's also Kat from Yero, right?
Mm-hmm.
She does amazing, amazing, like, graphics, and she's really humorous with it as well.
Yeah.
She's super funny. So Kat and I are doing a few things together, so she's just phenomenal. But honestly, I think every Insta account's got something to give. Like, I'm a massive foodie, so I'll sit on, like, Bo and Birdie, I'll sit on Ocho, like, and I'll just be staring at their food, like...
Making yourself hungry.
So, yeah, it literally... And it depends what kind of, like, mood you're in. Like, if you're hungry, you're looking at foodie ones. If you're feeling creative, you're looking at illustrations.
Yeah.
I love, like, I love Instagrams that have just got the funny quotes.
Yeah.
Like, I feel as if I learn a lot from Instagram and actually social media in general, like the Facebook community, I learn stuff from every day.
Yeah.
Because women share advice, I'm like, never thought about that, which is brilliant. So I think anything that you learn from is worthwhile following.
Yeah.
Anything that makes you feel low, don't follow.
Because, I've started doing that now. Yeah. Life's too short.
Life's too short, and like the... That old saying, comparison is the thief of joy, is so, so true. So if you're looking at Instagram accounts, and it could be for anything, it could be business related, it could be personal, it could be anything, and they make you feel rubbish, just don't look.
Yeah, I don't know why we do it to ourselves. Why do we subject ourselves to things that make us feel crap?
I don't know. I think sometimes you might have a wee day where you... It's almost like you punish yourself. But I'm actually... I've started being really good with it, because like I don't even... Like, my friends are like, oh, did you see that picture? And I'm like, no.
Because
I'm like, I'm so constantly working.
Yeah.
That I'm like, so then someone will say, so I'm then, all right, okay, I'm going on. But I don't know what's going on with Instagram. They keep changing that algorithm.
Yeah.
And I'm not, it's quite hard because you're missing stuff.
Yeah, it's really frustrating.
It's really frustrating.
And they can just kind of do that.
And you can, I know.
It impacts your business.
It impacts your business, because I even like see when you go to the bit at the top and it shows like your views on your page. They have like, I don't know, they've halved
the
views. And then the likes in the pictures are all super low. And I think probably they want you to be boosting a lot now. Like, they want you to be putting money into it. But not everyone can do that.
No.
And I would never, like, buy the followers or buy the likes. No. Because I think for more than one, two, three reasons, but you would not see any return for your business from it.
Mm-hmm.
Don't get me wrong. Yeah, it would look good from the outside. Yeah. But it must cost so much money.
I know. And it's so obvious, I think.
It is obvious.
I think people, they'll be able to tell a mile away. Yeah. If you're suddenly getting hundreds, thousands of likes on pictures and your followers are like skyrocketing.
I know.
And then it can kind of take away your credibility if people think you're...
It's so hard. Like, and there's platforms now where you can go on and check if people have bought. So it's just that
you'll
way...
You'll get caught out eventually.
Yeah, I know. But by that point, maybe the growth has allowed them to get natural growth anyway.
Yeah.
So there is that, but I just wouldn't have the budget.
No.
Or the mental capacity to be... So I try not look at the numbers.
Yeah.
I think it's quite important. But yeah, definitely. There's actually too many accounts to mention. I love your account.
Oh,
I love following designers because I love seeing how they have brought other brands to life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I think designers are incredible people
mm-hmm.
because like they, if you're going to invest in anything at the beginning, make it a designer.
Yeah,
because it's just so important mm-hmm. to get that initial branding right and get the initial highlights and get the cover banners and make everything look as if it's been professionally done
mm-hmm.
and that affects the perception of your brand as well.
Yeah, I think it does make such a difference having such that from the get-go, having like this really strong presence, especially on social media now.
Absolutely.
I think it kind of, it does give you credibility.
It does, it gives you.
Because when you go onto like a good Instagram page and like a good brand, you're like, whoa, like you remember it.
You remember it because mm-hmm. they're using their palette right, they're using their brand and their style, everything is cohesive like we spoke about earlier on, so definitely worth investing.
But I'll definitely check out all those people. I'll tag them, I'll pop a post up and I'll tag them all on it so everyone can go and check them out.
Great.
So yeah, the final thing is for you to plug yourself. So what have you got going on, any events?
Oh, thank you.
Where can we find you?
Okay, so what's happening, so to find the GGC, fully inclusive group for all women,
mm-hmm.
You can search Glasglow Girls Club on Facebook and you'll find both the Facebook page and the group.
Yeah.
The Instagram's Glasglow Girls Club and the Twitter is Glasglow G Club.
Mm-hmm.
And so what I've got coming up, so I'm going to start doing regular brunches.
Oh.
So that's yet to be announced because I've got a partner that I'm doing it with. So that's really, really exciting. Mm-hmm. They're going to be, I think it's going to be a great thing for the people, the ladies in the group and the Web Club members as well.
Mm-hmm.
So Web Club members get 10% off all events.
All right.
So the brunches have been a focus of late. The merchandise has been a focus of late. And I'm doing a big, massive Christmas party.
Wow.
So this is a wee exclusive. I'm doing a big, massive Christmas party on the 23rd or 4th of November.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever the Saturday is, that's right. The night. And I'm organising that with one of my best friends who is a genius in events. In fact, two of my very good friends and they're just genius with events.
Mm.
And it's going to be a big party. So last year a lot of people were saying to me, are you going to do a Christmas party? Especially self-employed people, they were like, you know, we don't get a Christmas party. So I thought to myself, do you know what, this year I'm going to make it a big thing and it'll be round about the brand's first birthday, but it'll be November actually, so it'll be a couple of weeks before. But I'm going to use it as like a birthday party, a Christmas party, and that's going to be in the Crown Plaza.
That'll be amazing.
So there's going to be a lot of surprise things happening at that because I want it to be really wild.
Yeah, that's exciting.
Really exciting, Tracy from Thrill Events. So Thrill Events is a good one to follow on Instagram. Yeah. She is like, wow. She's going to make the whole place look like a winter wonderland.
Oh, that'd be amazing.
So she's just super amazing. So and Tequila Rosé, it's looking like they're going to be the drink sponsor.
Oh.
So Tequila Rosé, for people who are like, oh, I hate tequila.
I love tequila.
But Tequila Rosé doesn't taste like tequila.
Yeah.
It's like strawberry milk.
Mm-hmm.
So they are going to be doing a takeover and there's lots more to be announced. It's going to be a real party and there will be a charity element in terms of what I want to ask people who attend to do
mm-hmm.
is to wrap gifts for kids mm-hmm. and wrap gifts for families, women, bring them along so that I can kind of categorise them,
uh-huh.
and then I'm going to take them to shelters and like Women's Aid and just basically spread the gifts out.
Yeah, that's so nice.
So that's a wee bit different for because charity events are brilliant, but I thought, right, what could I do which I could just give it direct the next day?
Yeah,
and they've got mm-hmm. you know, so That'll be good. So that's like in the planning stages at the moment. So that'll be getting announced, like early. The kind of early announcement will be soon for that.
Right.
So I just need a few more things confirmed.
Yeah,
that's exciting.
That's exciting. Yeah. No, thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you for having me. I could speak to you all day.
It's been so fun. So make sure that you go and join the Glasgow Girls Club.
Definitely
worth joining.
You should probably see the web address as well.
Yeah.
Which is www.glasgowgirlsclub.com. The membership's shut just now,
mm-hmm.
But it'll be reopening kind of early August time.
So if they kind of follow the Facebook, will they get the announcements for
They'll get the announcements.
So definitely go and check that out. Thank you again.
Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you.
You're a brilliant interviewer.
Oh God, I'm not sure about that.
Yes, you are.
So thank you for listening to this episode of Mind Your Business. And join me in the next episode. Bye.
Bye.
If you want to be kept up to date on our newest episodes, or if you want to see what we've been talking about on each episode, be sure to follow us on all social medias on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook at Mind Your Business Podcast. See you in the next episode.